what I want to do, especially tonight, having sort of said that general stuff, is that I want to say, I want to actually take us through the things that are in the folder, which are the texts that are most nearly finalized. That is one in the evening prayer and two Eucharistic rites. So you can see what's happened as a result of the church's feedback. If you look at the evening prayer, the highlights there are simple enough and they give you some sense of what's going on. You'll remember that in the 2013 version of morning and evening prayer, we prayed, we follow too much the deceits and desires of our own hearts. Okay? The attempt in being clear and incompetently, divisive. What does that mean in the 21st century? Okay? That is the issue that the liturgy is supposed to work with. And again, because poetry or musicality plays in, for the people's piety, you've got to have the same rhythm. So you've got to find another two-syllable word that'll work in place of divisive. Okay? So, deceit. One wonderful, helpful soul. I know not whether the soul was ordained or lay, but wrote into us and asked us a simple question. Andrew remembers that is to say, is it ever to any extent all right to follow your own deceits? Well, actually, it is all right to follow your own devices. I mean, you're looking at your holy devices or unholy devices and your own thinking and planning and imagining. But it's never all right to follow your own deceits. So what did we do? We went back to the matter. We had 5 years of explanation of what devices means. Emphasized a bit by this regard, Sayer's novel, that's the devices and desires, that's all part of our heritage. So, devices is back. Another piece of what happened as we did the work, you'll see in Spare All Those and Restore All Those, you remember that the old form of text was Stand About Those and Restore All Those. And again, some of the feedback that came from the church was, can we insert all there? Because rhythmically, it doesn't create any problems. And so in a congregation, if somebody is saying, spare all those, or somebody else is saying, I'll spare all those, it winds up with everybody being together, which is, of course, the purpose of common prayer. Everybody sitting together. So rhythmically, those walls show up. And on this first page, this is the same thing that happened with the with morning prayer. On page 2, he pardons and absolves. I'm not sure why, Henry, you all recall why we didn't have and absolves in the first form of this. One of the things that was important for us to learn in our province that included the US and Canada was, for instance, that Canada has never had any form of these prayers that looked like 1979. Canada never had a form of the Psalter that looked like 1979. So again, how do we bring one, how do we put this common prayer for one church? Because again, in this tradition, there's this understanding that getting things interiorized actually is a huge piece of full formation and catechesis for the people. And again, our tradition is peculiarly that tradition. We're the only liturgical church that begins with a prayer that asks Almighty God to cleanse the thoughts of our hearts. And that's a bizarre idea, unless you're angry. it's right brain thinking, kind of left-handed action. It's about what you love, not about what you think. Also, Western Christianity is kind of left side, right in what you mean stuff, if you want to do the break. Okay? So we have this understanding of liturgy in which it has much to do with emotions and with loving the Lord, as opposed to necessarily being right in our thinking about it, and that loving Him will produce rightness in our thinking, and perhaps as well as having right thinking will produce right loving. The long digression I have solved, it wasn't in the original text. It wasn't in the 2013 version. No reason for it not to say pardons and absolves. The other forms of absolution are given in that form. You'll note in the inventory that glory be to the Father is back. We should go to that once tonight. And again here, what the liturgical task force recommended to the bishop of Utah, to the college of bishops was, in terms of traditional formulas, just use the traditional formula and provide a contemporary formula as an alternative, make it clear that it can be used. So it's perfectly all right, as the rubric there highlighted says, for a congregation, and most congregations now tend to print out the services they're using, or project the services they're using. So if you want to project glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever, amen, that's what that rubric points to, the direction that you've been using in that book. It also points you to the possibility of saying it in the way the 79 book did, which is everybody together and an alleluia rather than praise the Lord, the Lord's name of praise. The golden way in Anglicans was to use the translation of alleluia with a back and forth, praise the Lord, the Lord's name of praise. But again, it's not wrong to use alleluia, and what we're doing is trying to provide the church with freedom to do this while at the same time producing liturgies as people come into them that are in line with the common language of the tradition. What also, and this emerges in dealing with the Eucharistic text as well, is that the fact that the Roman Catholic Church, in its 2012-2013 revision of what had been the ICD texts, went back to glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, as both the beginning is now, and there shall be world without end. Amen. And the fact that they reverted to that as the standard form also affected the decisions of the liturgy task force in terms of folks saying things in the same way. Continuity, is there any lack of clarity? World without end, yes. Great theological debate about that. Again, what is world without end? It means until the end of this age. Or in secular law, war of Latin, to the ages of ages, but that meant, until the parousia. And that's still what it means. If this is not literally as clear, this is one where continuity of the whole tradition wins out over pure clarity. Again, you just, these are various calls. And you're welcome to break down on this and ask questions as you move to do so. But folks, hold on. The liturgy test course, again, because our church was formed, one of the great concerns for us was the theological accuracy. There was a theological conviction that what the scriptures taught, especially as understood by the patristic period, is what this church teaches. There was a concern. You saw it in the Blessed Be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Not getting into a modalism, but these are persons of the Trinity. And played out in the Gospel in the form that you used it from the 2013 book, we praise you, O God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The pieces of feedback was, that just isn't elegant. And the way it was in the 79 book, and the way the Greeks use it, we see your praise from God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Musically, whatever, just look much better. Can't use it. We establish that we're not modalists as a church. We've established. So, yes, again, the piety of the people, things that have gone deep in our people, don't need to be undone unless they need to be undone. Gracious isn't actually what the Greek word means. Proskuneion is hilarious language. Okay, so you could use joyful, you could use lansome, which there's a long tradition of within Anglicanism as the way to translate that. Gracious language is not actually what the text says. So that's. Yeah. Well, yeah, you can ask that question. If I said, boy, that was a lasting time to a 5-year-old, I think the 5-year-old would get the point that it was happening. Yeah, that's one. But again, you can see these things are calls. As Brother Henry said, the thing that the liturgy has been trying to do, how do we give text to the whole church that the whole church can use, and that as much as possible bring us all together? The other things I want to point, and this would be the same in morning prayer, I'll say one other thing about morning prayer when we get here. In terms of the way in which things are displayed on page 4, there's the return to what the 79 prayer was so successfully did, which was to put a traditional contemporary form where both were important, side by side rather than one on top of the other. You just remember the display. I'll also say the text of Common Prayer 2, the printed volume, which will have these texts and the texts that the people usually use. So there'll be baptism and confirmation. The pastoral rites, burial, marriage, those rites will be there. The special liturgies or special days won't be there. But in the printing of PCP2 and in the printing of this prayer that was produced, one thing we've come to understand is that because so many people are coming to us with no Christian background, or not from liturgical churches, is how can we present texts in ways that seem intuitive for people? So one of the things that Common Worship in England did successfully is that the people's responses are always printed in the same bold. So anytime you look on this prayer book and the 79 prayer book, he says, I've been printed in a way in which it says people or some of the people, and it's just the same text, the same form of text, as whether it's the Solomon speaking or everybody speaking together. What you're seeing at TCB2, and that'll be the trial, we assume will actually be true for the 2019 prayer, is that things that everybody says together are printed in the same bold, so it's intuitively obvious what everybody's supposed to say together. Even if it's just one. walked in the first time. And there's a lot of us in figuring out how we do this in ways that make our tradition accessible to those who come to us. If you look at the verticals and responses, one of the pieces of feedback that we received is, can we do what the 79 book did with having two alternate forms of suffrages? In one prayer, the answer we gave was no, that this lesser litany that really derives from the first prayer books is significant enough in the things that it prays for that we want it in both offices, and in the morning office, there's not an alternative. In the morning office, you remember in the 79 book, the second set of suffrages were the added verses of the Te Deum, and they were offered. That's the added verses of the Te Deum are printed in the way that Anglicans always printed the Te Deum, that you don't have to use these verses, but they're not printed as verses and responses. We did take the requests of the people in that the full school model is not original to Western tradition, it's an Eastern medium. Just as these verses, these suffrages and responses are actually part of the evening office in the Eastern Church. And so this sort of completes that set in the evening office. In terms of verses and responses, again, we're trying to understand what the prayer book is always praying. And if you said that the 1662 is the standard, that not only we said that, but all of the Catholic provinces have said that in the Jerusalem Declaration. So you'll note that the second set, where God goes and govern us and lead us in the way of justice and truth, originally, that was when God saved the queen. Okay? Well, and the way in which when folks are singing traditional Anglican music, the Lord saved the state, where works, queen has one syllable, state has one syllable. Well, why would we pray for the queen? What we had in the 79 prayer book and in the 2013 stuff was over saving our nations. Okay. That's a very nice thought, but that's actually not the purpose of that intercession. It's actually to pray for those who govern us. So what's happening here as part of the feedback and reflection on this is to say, well, if we were going to pray for this, we would no longer say, Lord, save the queen. We'd say, Lord, guide those who govern us. Remember that the response was, and guide us in the way of justice and truth, which is consistent with the earlier prayers. But the way in which to deal with this was to take the guide into those who govern and therefore lead us in the ways of justice and truth. So this is, again, to be truer to what this short litany has always been. You tend to remember what the response of Alex, you certainly will, Jonathan. The response that is highlighted after the peace in our time, O Lord, for it is thou, Lord, only that fightest for us. I fought for that, but I lost. I just love the Old Testament image of the Lord fighting for us. Only thou, Lord, fight us for us. The best I could do. But again, this is and identify my mighty power comes much closer than what we have pre-written 79 and 2013 version of this we pray. We never called me out. David. have a point? Kind of really looked at. But again, the question is, if the standard for doctrine of worship is what became the Restoration prayer book after the English Commonwealth period, if that's the standard, what was it seeking to pray in this litany? And it was actually not praying for the nation, it was praying for the governors. So that's. Well, sure. And again, by praying for the king or the queen, you were praying for Her Majesty's government. And how do we do that here? By praying for those governments, which for us also takes in all of the local magistrates and the. But of course, in England, the notion of praying for queens within local magistrates too. So this again, then to help understand, how do we pray what Anglicans have prayed. And this will go deep into the souls of our people. You'll note that the colleague of the day from the College of Christian Years highlighted one of the things that we've done is to recognize that some things weren't clear in either the 79 book or the 2013 first show of this with the offices. When in so many circumstances, one is in the colleague of the day, some people would read the colleague for Tuesday. The colleague for the day is the colleague of the preceding Sunday or of the feast being preserved. It's not, the intention is in Anglicanism that there's a prayer for the week or a prayer related to another day, and that's the colleague. And sometimes rubrics which we attempted to be clear with are not as clear as they might have been. The issue of bestowing freedoms, the principle of subsidiarity on which the province was founded, you can make these decisions at the lowest level possible, was it such an issue for the ordinary being the local parish director or the bishop of the diocese, if it's such an issue that he's convinced that it needs to be this other form, he didn't tell you to do it, and then you better do it. My hunch is he won't tell you how to recite the glory. I might be the right thing. Again, one of the realities with this book, which I think we're glad about, is, and the college bishop is very glad about, is that there are lots of freedoms bestowed. The place where the unity group comes is in the language that's used in common. But there, you can, again, if in your parish you have had the daily office and you've always said the glory this way in the 79 form, and with everybody joins together for the whole of it, and hallelujah, except during Lent, then probably we all like to do that. But again, if you went to another congregation and they used the other form, you stumble over it, but you understand that this was still the same church and this was still the same right. And then we're all working in this principle of common prayer. What's highlighted in the rubric at the bottom of page 6 and the top of page 7 is actually an alteration on what was there before. What was there before was that it said a hymn may be sung and then three intercessions may be spoken. What we've gotten back from the church is that it's far more, it makes far more sense to offer the free prayer after the only stated prayers, then the same hymn, and then because you just change the word having it, what you change spiritually what's going on, and then you have these two final prayers that you may say, or you may go to the sermon on. Yeah, again, the rubrics allow all that. But that's just a recommendation. Again, it says here maybe. The recognition of college is that in most cases the use of the of three prayers at the end of a third collect and prayer commission probably makes more sense than every. Again, this is not something that we want to dine in any ditches about. And if you wanted to do it the other way, you could certainly ask the ordinary if it was all right. And I suspect you would say, oh yes, it's all right. bigger things to buy than these, right? Again, much debated in college issues. Reverend John Christensen, since 1979, has read, when Jewish theory gathered together, his name will be in the mix of that, which is a single biblical verse. You've got to go a verse further to get, you will grant the request. It's not a direct follow-on. So how do we decide this? And the way in which it was decided is, okay, in what form did it come into the prayer book? It came into the prayer book in 1662. Because the Caroline divines were very interested in the Church of the East. So much of the Eastern practice of the Church was opened up by that generation of Anglicans. And so the prayer of St. John Chrysostom comes in the 1662 prayers, which then appears. And so, in what form does the East use it? The East prays, when two or three are gathered together, you will grant their requests. That's actually the John Chrysostom version. So if we're calling this the prayer of St. John Chrysostom, we probably, there's not everybody who's ultimately happy with that. Though we can point out that for the Canadians and for the Hari, that's how they most pray that prayer. It's only the 79th who prayed in this other version.